sure. I mean, it was a kind of a last minute thing. It was a part that I had come up with on the road last year, and just played it for Mark one day when we were putting song ideas together, and he really liked it. So we kind of put it on the back burner, and it was one of the last songs we arranged. So it was cool how that song came together, because you know I came in with that, and I had the riff thing where the band comes in, and then we just kind of sat in a room together, and it evolved from there. And most of the time when you approach a song that way, you leave rehearsal very frustrated, because it's hard to get everybody on the same page, and for whatever reason that one really happened in a big way. I think we knew once it was done that it was something special.
Well, honestly, most of the album to me is, and not the sound or the technique, but very Metallica-esque, because you have two or three songs in each song itself. You know, you listen to anything like Ride the Lightning, it doesn't sound like it's one song. You have three songs built into one.
Right.
And that's what you guys are doing on this new album. It's, you know, you're saying one thing and totally changing it up on the next portion of the song. It's something that nobody's doing out there. So,
cool.
You know, thank you for that.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
I think that song kind of captures our differences, you know, on that one, because that Miles stuck to his traditional. He improvises in the studio. He likes to keep it. He likes to capture lightning in a bottle. Where I go into the studio a little more prepared, you know, which when you can capture that lightning in a bottle, it's the best solo in the world, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I like to have my comfort blanket. I like to have a pretty much an outline of what I'm going to do. But Miles is very fluid, his vibrato, his bending, his phrasing, his chord tone soloing, and everything is, I think, his strengths.
Thanks, Mark.
Yeah, you're welcome, Miles.
With Mark, it's definitely, you definitely know it's Mark. That's the, I think, the real sign of a iconic player, you know, somebody that just... There, you know it's them within a few bars, you know, and I think that's very few people have that, so it doesn't surprise me that you were able to pick up on that.
Very much like Hendrix, Van Halen.
Sure.
It's all in the hands.
Tone, a lot of the tone is in the fingers. You know, people like myself buy a million amps and always sound pretty similar. You know, a lot of it, 80% of it's right in the fingers. Yeah, you know, we keep pushing Miles to do it, but the scream just won't come out of him. It's more like a chirp. When we were first putting the record together, I think we wanted to have a record that was fun for us to play live night after night. So, you know, we were just putting together these high-energy songs one after the other, and it took a while before we shifted gears and knew we had to have some dynamics, and then wrote songs like All Ends Well and Lover, and those were two of the later songs we put together. Dan Cotullo is the director, and he said, let's do a performance video. And his initial thought was, let's have all your road cases and stuff like in your warehouse just scattered around so it doesn't look like a proper stage setup. And we'll have film rolling on all these multiple cases all over the place. It would be kind of chaotic. Then when we got to the set, he had figured the best look was these three big screens behind us. And night after night, he would send, we kind of brainstormed on the type of imagery everybody wanted. He went and licensed it all, and we'd approve it along the way. And he had some pretty, some gnarly stuff that had, some of it had to go, but it's all nice. And I think it fits the one line, Addicted to Pain, you know, because there's a lot of people,
yeah,
you know, torturing themselves in one way or another in there. But the song itself is not about that.
Well, it kind of is, in a sense. I mean, the song is about, you know, you have people that put themselves in these positions where it's, from the outside looking in, it doesn't seem logical that they would stay there, that it's painful, that it's unhealthy. So I think I think that kind of fits. I mean, I've seen a number of people in that scenario in my lifetime. I've certainly been that person. So I think that song kind of takes all of that and looks at it from the outsider's perspective.
And more emotional pain, not necessarily physical.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. Cool. Turn off the lights, close your eyes and tell me
what you see. I'll bet it tells and how... You know, you just write the riff in that tuning or the musical part in that tuning. And then the tough part sometimes is to find, me and Miles write parts. We don't sit and write an entire song and say, here, let's learn this song, because then we don't feel like we've contributed. So the hard part is once you have an odd tuning, like say an open G tuning, and you have this great verse or a great chorus, you're going to have to go and dig through your stuff and just so happen to find a verse that has the same tempo, same feel, same tuning, and sometimes it's hard. But sometimes you can take something in another tuning and just transpose it and change the tuning, but sometimes you can't.
Was the character.
Yeah. Absolutely. Some of those open strings, that's the beauty of alternate tunings, is those open strings really, and the strange, sometimes strange chords that you can come up with these alternate tunings. The chord voicings are always what's what I like. That's what makes those tunings unique. It's tough to say. I think we all have multiple sides of our personalities, and Alter Bridge is definitely our baby. You know, we've worked so hard on Alter Bridge, and I think if it went away, we'd be devastated. So this is a big part of us. And but at the same time, I think whatever you're working on, I'm sure when Miles is working on Slash, 100% of his attention is on that Slash album. And when I'm working on my solo record, I'm making sure that that's the best solo album that I can put out. But when we come back to Alter Bridge, the good thing about having all these projects is when we come back, Alter Bridge is fresh to us. It's new again. We have experiences to draw from and new topics to write about.
Yeah, I think that being both extreme perfectionists, it's hard to go into a scenario and think, oh, I'm only going to give it 50%. So we give 1,000% in everything that we attempt, it's just the curse of being a perfectionist, you know.
Mm-hmm. And what's incredible, also, you're so quiet, you know, when you're speaking, yet on stage or on the albums, you're crazy, insane,
crazy.
You know, nice and loud, and you know.
Yeah, you know, I get all that stuff out on stage.
Schizophrenic.
Yeah, trademark that.
I like that. And actually, that's a Nuno Betancourt thing. That was the title of a record of his a long time ago, yeah. I just thought that was really clever.
That's giving him credit right there, right?
Nuno
now
rules.
You can use it.
Yeah, there you go.
I think the song that inspired us the most was Long Way to the Top, AC/DC. We would play that song before we went on stage, and it's kind of such a... It gets you amped for the show, you know.
It's a great song.
That one line is just—it's so true. And we've struggled for so long with Alter Bridge. We've played for 50 people. We've played for 20 people. We've come a long way, and that song really drives that point home.
Thanks for sticking by us. I mean, we've been doing this now for almost 10 years, and we always talk about the fact that our fan base seems to be so passionate and steadfast. And it's funny because when we do these interviews and we talk with people at radio or in the media, they'll definitely chime in with, you know, their experiences with our fans and how they don't. It's so rare to see people who are that passionate about a band and that loyal anymore. So we're very cognizant of that and very grateful for that. And I know it sounds cliche, but the fact of the matter is we're nothing without them. So thank you. Yeah,
right before we set this up, I was like, I hate to sound like a fanboy, but I love doing it. I'm actually in love with it. I don't think I've taken out of the my CD player.
The 8-track.
Yeah, the 8-track player. Yeah, I actually have it on vinyl, too.
I actually, I don't know.
I'm going to get a date on the record player.
Nice.
Probably get them cheap now.
Actually, some of them are expensive.
Really?
Yeah, I'm a big, in the last 9 months, I've really gotten into it. My wife gave me a record player for Christmas. And it's nothing fancy, but $300 record player. So I started researching it. And you can spend a fair, you know, fair amount of money on it.
The stylus.
I guess that's the primary. That's your bad boy right there. But I got to tell you, until you sit down and listen to records on vinyl, don't know what you're missing.
And all the hidden devil lyrics, you got to push
go backwards and stuff. Yep.
Yeah, well, that's what I love. I love to listen to Satan.
Addicted to pain backwards. That's what.
It's I Heart You, Satan.